Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Assalamu alaikum and welcome to another episode of In His Own Words. In this program, as you will be aware, we look at the writings of Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad of Qadian, may peace and blessings of Allah be upon him, who was the promised Messiah and Imam Mahdi. And we focus on his books, which total up to over 90. And we read his books, we study them in light of what he has written in his very own words. Today, inshallah, the book that we'll be covering is Lecture Luthiana, which was a lecture written by Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad of Qadian, alayhi salatu wasalam, and we'll be studying it, seeing what the promised Messiah, alayhi salam, has said in this book. Today we have with us here in the program, Atai Rabbi, Hadi Sahib, and Sarjeel Ahmed Sahib. Jazakumullah, gentlemen, for being with us here today. Inshallah, like I said, we'll be studying this book. Sarjeel Sahib, Lecture Luthiana, you know, obviously the name infers that it was a lecture which was written by the Promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam. If you can just give us a brief background and then we'll get straight into it.
Right. And Kasab, just as you said, Lecture Luthiana, it was a lecture not only written by the Promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam, but this lecture, unlike many of the other lectures, was himself delivered by the Promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam, on the 4th of November, 1905. And so the Promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam, he starts off the lecture by speaking of a lot of the opposition that happened, a lot of the hardship that he faced. But regardless of all this, he says that Allah the Almighty helped me so much that all those opposed me vanished, but I still remain. He also goes on to cover many of the important fundamental topics of Islam, including jihad and the death and second coming of Jesus, alayhi salatu wasalam. The Promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam, he starts off this lecture and he says, "When I was here 14 years ago, I had but a few companions, and my opponents were ever so vocal in condemning me as a liar, non-believer, and antichrist. In their eyes, I was as one both damned and accursed. They thought it was only a short matter of time before my Jamaat would stand rejected and as a result disintegrate to ultimately vanish without a trace." The Prophet ﷺ further says that the truth is this: "Today I thank God as I look back to the time when I had but a handful of people by my side and the members of my Jamaat were very small in number. Today you witness a large Jamaat with me whose membership has already reached 300,000. It is increasing by the day and will certainly reach hundreds of millions." And today, as we see, the Jamaat has reached to so many millions of people, to so many places around the world. And it is a direct manifestation of the words of the Promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam.
Absolutely. And following on from that, you know, where the Promised Messiah, in between what you've read, he talks about how, had this been a man-made movement, you know, we would have seen that it would have been crushed ages ago, it would have been destroyed, it would have finished a long time ago. But the Promised Messiah alludes to this very point and says that because this is God's own, you know, formed Jamaat or community, it's still standing and it's still progressing today. The Promised Messiah then further goes on to talk about how the Promised Messiah, what he's endured throughout his mission. And then he talks about how this is very similar to what the Holy Prophet has had to endure in his life. He states, "Just pause and consider. All clerics, custodians of shrines and their ilk rose in opposition to me and joined hands even with the followers of other faiths. Sparing no effort, they labeled me an apostate in order to alienate the Muslims at large. When all this failed, they started court proceedings against me." And he further goes on to state that, "In fact, it is a well-established practice that when an enemy finds no argument or reason, he opts for persecution and murder. He plans the banishment of his opposition from his native land and hatches a variety of plots and conspiracies against him. This is what happened when the disbelievers of Mecca became helpless against the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and all their efforts were stymied. They conspired to kill him, imprison him, or expel him from his homeland. His companions too were subjected to torture, but in the end, all the designs and intentions of the Meccans were frustrated. Exactly the same old story is now being repeated in my case." So the Promised Messiah talks about how opponents, you know, in their frustration, and this is what we see on a day-to-day basis, even with the Jamaat today, that because they have no leg to stand on to oppose the Jamaat, they resort to violence, to murder cases, to whatever extreme they can get their hands on.
Yeah, and, you know, moving on from that, He then speaks of the fact that in face of all this persecution, you know, his Jamaat, it grew, and you know, over a span of 14 years. Firstly, of course, he mentions 14 years from the time when he came to Ludhiana, but he then goes on to mention that 25 years ago, no one knew of him, no one knew who he was, no one knew of his claim, or you know, even the name Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad. But at that time, God Almighty addressed him and actually, you know, granted him a revelation in which he prophesied that thousands of people would actually join your fold. So in face of all this persecution, you know, you have this one man who claims, despite all this, that, you know, God will make my community grow. And he makes reference to one of the revelations that he received during that time, which is يَأْتُونَ مِن كُلِّ فَجٍ عَمِيكَ وَيَأْتِيكَ مِن كُلِّ فَجٍ عَمِيكَ. And the rest of the revelation will be on the screen before you. And the translation of this revelation is, they will come by every distant track and will come to you from afar. Don't turn away from God's creatures with disdain, and don't get wary of people. My Lord, leave me not alone, and you are the best of inheritors. So here the promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam, is claiming that, you know, people will come to join his fold from faraway lands. Mm. And, you know, despite all this opposition, people will accept his message. But a question that the promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam, now raises is that how is it even possible for a man who is completely anonymous, a man who no one knows of, to make such a bold statement that God will, you know, allow my community to grow in such a manner that thousands of people will join my community? And this is exactly what he says when he writes, just imagine whether it is within the scope of human power to foresee such an event 25 to 30 years in advance, and that too about one's own self. What is even more remarkable is that all this should happen exactly as predicted. No man can know for certain about his mortal life from one moment to the next, or even predict whether he will live to draw the next breath. How then can he foretell such an event? So the promised Messiah, alayhi wasalam, is, you know, referring to his own truthfulness from this revelation. He's saying that, you know, these revelations which were given to me so many years ago, seeing them being fulfilled in such a manner, especially you know, keeping in mind the fact that I was completely anonymous before I received these revelations, is a testimony to my truthfulness.
Absolutely. And obviously these words, they go on, and even today we see that these words are being fulfilled to the letter. You know, people in their thousands are accepting the Ahmadiyya Muslim Jamaat under the banner of Islam Ahmadiyyat. And this is something that we want to remind our viewers, that this prophecy is something which carries on today. The legacy of the books of the Promised Messiah continues today. They haven't withered away. They continue to be a means of studying, a means of, you know, flourishing throughout the world, of the Ahmadiyya Muslim Jamaat flourishing throughout the world. And this is what we quickly, if I remind the viewers, that you can read these books for yourselves. If you go to www.alislam.org, and in the library section under the English books, you can see these books, especially this book, Lecture Ludhiana, the various other books that we've studied in our previous episodes, and the books written by Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad, which specifically have been translated in English and otherwise as well. And this is something, you know, like I said, it really does inspire you to believe in the promised Messiah, that it happened at a time when he was completely alone.
No, Qasim Sahab, there's one thing that is important to mention. Some people may say, look, weren't there other people that made similar claims, and were they not successful? Were there not other people like the Promised Messiah of Islam? The Promised Messiah of Islam goes head on to this, and he responds to this. He says, I challenge you to cite just one instance of an imposter since the time of Adam to the present day who made such a prophecy 25 years in advance while he was still in a state of anonymity. If anyone can produce such a precedent, then this entire movement and mission shall surely stand rejected. He goes on to say that I wrote a book 25 years ago called Brahina Ahmadiyya. And in this book, I predicted, he says, the whole world shall support you, and I shall cause you to become famous in the world, and shall not allow your enemies to succeed. Now I say once again, can this be the claim of an imposter? If you still insist that this could very well be the work of an imposter, then produce a precedent to prove it. And we see to this day that there is no such example like the promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam, of a man who makes such a prediction and is so successful in the same way as the promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam, and has received the same favors and bounties from Allah the Almighty.
Right, and he then goes on to also explain the fact how important prophecies are in establishing the truthfulness of a prophet's claim. He explains that, you know, prophecies are there and signs are there so people can distinguish who is right and who is wrong. So not only has his community flourished, not only has his message been accepted, but all those prophecies that he's received within that time period from God Almighty are continuously being fulfilled. But with that, he also mentions that there are, however, some prophecies which are abstruse in meaning. There are some which can be subtle and can be difficult for some people to comprehend, especially those who are short-sighted and only manage to understand which is very obvious. Mm. Now, you know, giving a solution to actually realizing or distinguishing which prophecies are true, you know, especially if someone who's short-sighted or only understands that which is very obvious, he gives a solution to that person, that what can he do in that case if he does come across a prophecy which doesn't seem like it is being outwardly fulfilled to the letter. So the promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam, states that people create doubts about these prophecies, which in reality come to be fulfilled according to divine precedence. Even if the manner of their fulfillment is incomprehensible, the duty of a believer and God-fearing person is to consider the prophecies which are plain and obvious instead of those which are subtle, and note how many of them have come true. Outright rejection is contrary to righteousness. One should consider with honesty and fear of God those prophecies which have already been fulfilled. But who can muzzle the mouth of the impulsive? I am not the lone victim of such treatment. Moses, alayhi salatu wasalam, Jesus, alayhi salatu wasalam, and the Holy Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wasalam, underwent similar ordeals. Little wonder, therefore, if I too face opposition. This was always going to happen, as it was in exact consonance with divine practice. I, for one, believe that one single testimony is enough to convince and overwhelm a true believer. But here we see not one, but hundreds of signs. In fact, I can say with full authority that these signs are virtually innumerable. So the promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam, is saying that instead of looking at those prophecies which you may not completely understand, because they might be subtle in meaning, they might be, you know, abstruse, why not look at all those other prophecies that were fulfilled, those ones that were outwardly fulfilled? And unfortunately, there will be some people who will still, you know, pick out faults. But even then, there's nothing to worry about, because this was the case with prophets before as well. This same thing happened with Moses, alayhi salatu wasalam, Jesus, alayhi salatu wasalam, and even the Holy Prophet Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wasalam.
No, obviously, I mean, these signs are such that they're left slightly ambiguous. I wouldn't say fully, entirely. Mm-hmm. There is a little bit of ambiguity left in it for the people to decide among the people who is right and who is wrong, who is a believer and who is a non-believer. Otherwise, if it was so clear in meaning, mm-hmm. we see the promised Messiah say this in other places, that if it was so clear in meaning, then who would reject it? You know, yeah. Everyone should accept it then, and everyone would.
And then there wouldn't be any reward for faith, as in the Absolutely. Whole practice is that, you know, you believe in that which God grants to you, you know, keeping firm faith in, you know, what you see to be true. You know, if that type of, you know, examination, you can say, is not there, then what reward do you, you know, deserve?
And obviously we believe in that reward, you know, in the hereafter and even in this world. And in fact, the promised Messiah then talks about how, you know, he's been rewarded to such an extent, and he shows his gratefulness and appreciation and pays homage to God Almighty for the immense blessings that he's been given by God Almighty. And these blessings, he says, this is followed by what the promised Messiah initially had to go through, complete rejection from even his own people. And the promised Messiah alludes to this, and he states, God sustained me at a time when my own people had risen against me. Man feels helpless and forlorn when his own people turn against him, for it is these who constitute one's limbs and organs. They are his only support. Of course, people of other faiths would oppose, for they would feel their faith was under attack. But when one's own people turn against him, It is no small matter to survive and succeed. It is a great sign indeed. So obviously, you know, when the Muslims found out that he is claiming to be the Messiah, when the Messiah, in fact, according to them, was in the heavens, he was, you know, entirely rejected. And this was something which not only went against him, you know, in front of the Jews and Christians, but it really weakened the Muslim state. When Muslims were fighting amongst Muslims, there was, you know, just division amongst the Muslims throughout the country and throughout the world. This was something which showed the sign of weakness among the Muslims at that time. Then the Promised Messiah, alayhi salam, he goes on to say, I have to say it with deep regret and a heavy heart that people were not only hasty but also callous in opposing me. The only point of dispute between us was the death of Jesus, which I proved and continue to prove. And obviously, you know, we find the Promised Messiah in various books of his. This was one of the hallmark teachings that he brought, which unfortunately it didn't, I mean, if Muslims hadn't brought this interpolation in Islam, it wouldn't have needed to be, you know, cleared. But it unfortunately crept into Islam, the concept of the life of Jesus living in the heavens. And that was something that the Promised Messiah had to clear, because without that, Islam couldn't have moved on. And the Promised Messiah, obviously talking about these very concepts, how he proved it through the Ahadith and the Holy Quran, the verses of the Holy Quran, he further goes on to say, but before even examining my views at length or listening to my arguments, these people crossed all limits in opposing me, so much so that they called me an apostate and imputed to me whatever their whim or fancy dictated. In keeping with the demands of honesty, righteousness, and fear of God, they should have asked me to explain my viewpoint. Had my position been against the word of God and the Holy Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then they would of course have had the right to describe me in whatever terms they wished and called me an imposter, antichrist and whatnot. But I have stressed from the very beginning, and still do, that to deviate, however slightly, from the Holy Quran and the Holy Prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, is an act of rank disbelief. And this is obviously how balanced the teachings of the Promised Messiah alayhi salam are. Everything falls under the Holy Quran, everything falls under the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
You know, also, not only does the Promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam say that not only am I a Muslim, he himself recited the Kalma Shahada, but he goes on to say, it is also my conviction that Jesus Christ did not physically ascend to the heavens, nor is he still alive. To believe that Jesus alayhi salatu wasalam is alive is highly insulting and derogatory to the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You know, just to give a little bit of background, the Promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam was once lying down and he was feeling very sick. And Hazrat Amma Jan radiallahu ta'ala anha, she came and she said, you know, now the passage to Makkah is very easy and you can go do Hajj very easily. And the Promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam got up. He was so sad and he said, there's nothing more that I would love than to go and perform the Hajj, but I cannot bear to see the tomb of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Remember this incident and then listen to these words. If it is disrespectful to believe in the death of Jesus or even to think of it, then I ask, how can you permit this insolence and disrespect with regard to the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Indeed, you so brazenly announce his demise. Your ceremonial singers recount the events preceding the demise of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and you readily admit, even to the non-believers, that he did die. But I wonder what hits you so hard at the mere mention of the death of Jesus that it fills you with uncontrollable rage. I would not have been so hurt if you had also shed tears at the mention of the death of the Holy Prophet. But it is such a pity that you gladly accept the death of him who was the seal of the prophets and the Lord and Master of us all, but consider Jesus alayhi salatu wasalam to be alive, who pronounced himself unworthy even to unloose the shoelaces of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So, you know, it's so sad to think of the Muslim Ummah of this time and to think that in this day and age they can accept that the Holy Master, for which the heavens and the earth were created for, is lying, you know, and is gone, but they still believe that a Rasul to the Bani Israel is still alive and he is going to come and reform them in this age. And so it's very sad.
And you know, just moving on with that point, the Promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam, then, you know, says that the truth of the matter is that if anyone should be kept alive, it should be the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, because the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was a prophet who was sent for the whole of mankind. Yeah. And another thing he also goes on to mention is that we can actually understand how important the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was, and we can also understand that Jesus must have died from the incidences that took place right after his demise sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So we see that when the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam passed away, at that time the companions, they couldn't believe it at all. They were completely shocked with his demise. They couldn't imagine, you know, that at some point in time the Holy Prophet ﷺ would leave them, you know. And at that time, you know, and this incident is quite famous, and everyone knows this, that at that time Hazrat Umar radiallahu anhu, he then stood up and he said that no one should dare to say that the Holy Prophet ﷺ has passed away, because if you do so, then I will cut off your head. You know, that's how much, you know, emotionally overwhelmed he was by his demise. But at that time, Hazrat Abu Bakr then stood up and he recited a verse from the Holy Quran. And he said, "Ma Muhammadun illa Rasulun qad khalat min qablihi ar-rusul." That Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam was but a messenger, and all messengers before him have passed away. You know, as soon as the companions heard this, they calmed down, you know, they realized that, okay, you know what, this definitely makes sense. A lot of them were saying it seemed as though this revelation was, you know, sent down for the first time ever, whereas this verse was revealed a very long time ago. And they realized that, you know, the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was only a man, just like all prophets before him were only men, were only humans. And just as they passed away, the Holy Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was also bound to pass away. You know, so this also shows the fact that the companions at that time didn't believe that Jesus was alive, because if they did, the first thing that they would have said is that, wait a minute, fine, you're reciting this verse, but Jesus still is still alive. Exception. You know, there is an exception. Yeah. So how can this, why should this even apply to the Holy Prophet where he's more important? So the Promised Messiah والسلام, says, had the companions known and believed that Jesus والسلام, was still alive, the news of the death of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would have given them the shock of their lives. They were all lovers of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They could not tolerate that any prophet other than the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam should have been still alive. How could they possibly reconcile to the death of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam with Jesus alaihi wasallam still alive? And the Promised Messiah then goes on to say that, you know, this incident in itself, first and foremost, this is the first ever consensus amongst the companions of the Holy Prophet, where they unanimously agreed on one thing, and that is, you know, that the Holy Prophet has passed away. And because of this, this is also an agreement that all prophets before him have passed away without any exception. And he also says this incident in itself is, you know, one of the greatest proofs that Jesus must have died. And this is why he states, "I have emphasized over and over again that this is the most convincing argument which establishes once and for all the death of Jesus alayhi salam. The demise of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was too extraordinary an event not to have shocked the companions."
Right. You know, I was thinking about the verse that you mentioned, "Ma Muhammadun illa Rasul qad khalat min qablihi Rasul." And the Promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam, not only does he give sort of the emotional aspect of it, the historical aspect, but he also says, if you look at the very words of the Holy Quran, they give you the answer themselves. He says, "I am sorry to say that some ignorant people who are too hasty and precipitate in pronouncing judgment, while agreeing that this verse was recited by Hazrat Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu, contend that Jesus alayhi salatu wasalam did not fall within its scope. I really do not know what to say to such ignorant people. They profess to be divines, yet they say things so absurd. They fail to specify the word in the verse which singles out Jesus as an exception. Furthermore, God has said nothing in the verse which could lend itself to more than one interpretation. God himself defines the term qad khalat." So we see that in the verse that was just recited, the words qad khalat come, indeed has passed. But God himself goes on to translate and to specify the meaning of those words. And he says, Afa immata aw qutila, that then if he dies or he is killed. So we see that there are only two options now of the words qad khalat, that indeed they have passed, that either they pass away by the decree of Allah or they are killed. God did not say here, or if they were physically taken to the heavens with their spiritual or their physical bodies. God has only given two options. They're either killed or they die themselves. But unfortunately, the people or the Muslim ummah of today is ignorant to this fact. The Prophet Muhammad further says, this verse alone would have sufficed. But I would like to add that so intense is the love and fondness for the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that even today his followers cannot help shedding tears at the mere mention of his demise. For the companions at that moment, the grief was naturally far more painful and poignant. So, you know, it's very clear if one, again, these words are those that are of the Promised Messiah, Sallallahu, who was a reformer of the age. And they point out to so much, if only one is to understand.
So following on from that, the Promised Messiah والسلام, then makes reference to a prophecy of the Holy Prophet وسلم, in which he prophesies that in the latter days, in the time of the Messiah, it will be the Promised Messiah والسلام, who will refute the idea that Jesus is alive. And in turn, this will then refute the doctrine of Trinity or the Christian doctrine, basically.
And obviously the unity of God will ultimately prevail through that.
Yeah. So, but for this, the Promised Messiah والسلام, says that, you know, for this to happen, you have to understand one thing, which is that this world is a world which is determined by cause and effect. You know, for this to happen, there has to be a cause and effect for this prophecy to be fulfilled. You know, just as to quench your thirst, you require water to do so. Yeah. So in a similar fashion, for this prophecy, yaksiru salib, that, you know, that the doctrine of Christianity will be broken. You know, it was required that the Promised Messiah والسلام, do so. So making reference to this, the Promised Messiah والسلام, states, but the fulfillment of this prophecy has to be through some means, because God also employs means to attain an objective, just as he cures with medicine and satisfies hunger and thirst with food and water. Now that Christianity has become dominant and Muslims from different strata of society have entered its fold, God has willed Islam's ascendancy in keeping with his promise. The instrument he has employed to realize this end is, of course, the death of Jesus, which becomes the basis for bringing about the death of the religion of the cross and breaking its back. I repeat with full conviction that there can be no better strategy to make the Christians shed their wrong beliefs than to prove the death of Jesus.
And the Prophet goes on and fully just breaks the cross. He says, now let me address those who love to believe in Jesus as being alive. Capital punishment is awarded on the testimony of two witnesses. But here the number of witnesses supporting our contention is legion, and yet they persist in their disbelief. God says in the Holy Quran, Ya Isa, inni mutawaffika wa rafiuka ilayya. So the Promised Messiah argues here that, look, Allah the Almighty himself is saying that, O Isa, O Jesus, I first gave you death, and then I raised you up. If someone is to be raised up after death, there is only one way, and that's a spiritual death. But the Promised Messiah says, if you don't want to believe this, then look at the event of the Miraj. He goes on to say, the Holy Prophet wasallam saw Jesus والسلام, among the dead on the night of Miraj, the Ascension. No one can deny the authenticity of the tradition about the Ascension. Have a look for yourselves. Is Jesus alayhi salatu wasalam mentioned among the dead or somewhere else? Just as the Holy Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam saw the Prophet Abraham, Moses and others, so did he see Jesus alayhi salatu wasalam. There was nothing special or distinctive separating them. No one can deny the fact that Moses, Abraham and all the other prophets alayhimu salam have passed away and that the angel of death has conveyed them onto the next world. How then could a person who was alive in his physical body be with them? All these proofs are more than enough to satisfy a true Muslim. And so if you choose to believe that all those people that the Prophet Muhammad saw on the event of Miraj were dead, had passed away, had gone to heaven, then you should also, and you must also believe that Jesus Christ, والسلام, a humble prophet of God, was among those people who have passed away.
Absolutely. And now, obviously, we're coming to the close of the first program. And the point the Promised Messiah is now alluding to is, he first praises the Holy Prophet, والسلام, the fact that under his, blessing is the blessings of the Holy Prophet, والسلام, that we are able to partake in what we are doing at this very moment. And then the Promised Messiah says, another point worth mentioning, which it would be ungrateful of me not to mention, is that we live by the grace of God under the government of a kingdom which ensures peace all around and allows complete freedom to propagate and publicize our faith. We are also privileged to enjoy all kinds of facilities in these blessed days. Can there be greater freedom than that we openly criticize Christianity and no one stops us from doing so? But there was a time, and many who witnessed it are still alive, when no Muslim dared to even proclaim the adhan, which is the call to prayer, from the mosques. Not to speak of other sanctions, we could not even eat what was permissible in our religion. So the Promised Messiah talking about how the British government has given them so much freedom, and not the freedom of any worldly nature, but the freedom merely to practice his religion and practice the religion of Islam to the extent that you can actually target Christianity, which was the religion of the British government at that time. And you can even target that, living in the means of, morality and, ethical boundaries. But you can target it and raise any questions that you like about the religion, and no one was there to stop you. And the Promised Messiah then talks about how some of, the court cases, which he was, some of the challenges that he had to face due to some opponents who went to, initially be discussed, how people go to the extremes to annihilate or try to annihilate the righteous people because they don't have any leg to stand on when you're challenging them. And the Promised Messiah had two deputy commissioners who he had to face. One of them is the very well-known Captain Douglas, who we know in our Jamaat, in our community. And he proved that the Promised Messiah, alayhi salam, through his own, honesty and modesty, he proved that the Promised Messiah alayhi salam was true, and he announced that he was innocent, despite the fact that he was pursued by the opponents, and they tried to make him believe that he was guilty, Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad Sahib was guilty. And then the Promised Messiah, then at the end, he talks about how these opponents left no stone unturned, but the British government have always been just, and he prays for them, and he says, my opponents have never missed an opportunity to crush me and have left no stone unturned to destroy me. But just as God has protected all the prophets through his sheer grace, he has also protected me from all fires. Against the backdrop of these events, I can say with all the emphasis at my command that this government is far better than the Roman government under which Jesus, alayhi salam, suffered torment. Pilate, the governor in whose court Jesus was initially tried, was in fact a follower of Jesus, and so was his wife. That is why he washed his hands off Jesus' blood. The governor, despite being a follower of Jesus, did not show the courage that Captain Douglas showed. Jesus was innocent in that case, just as I was innocent in this. I speak and testify from experience that God has gifted these people with the courage to be just. And the Promised Messiah's life is a testament to this, how the British government enabled the religion of Islam to prosper. And it was obviously only a matter of God Almighty making it a decree by sending the Promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam at that time in that very area. This was Lecture Ludhiana, which we discussed and studied today. This is the first half, inshallah. We will be discussing the second half of Lecture Ludhiana in the next program. Until next time, from all of us here, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu.